Pot of Thunder presents the following trailer for the film 300, starring Tom Cottle, filmed on location at Stardust Bowl.
Death in the pro shop is the greatest glory I can achieve in my life. Be afraid! Stardust will burn to the ground! Threaten my people with oil patterns and splits? This is madness! Madness! This is Stardust! Stardust! Tonight we bowl in hell! Give them a handicap, but take from them the series! You will stand alone. Who do you think you are? I am! We're in for one wild episode. Rockets 300.
Oh, yeah.
Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in rock and roll podcasting. I guess who?
Oh. Here's my buddy Andy.
That's right. It's America's little brother. It's your buddy Andy. As always, I'm joined by Gnarly Nick, the garlic dragon.
Bam! Bam!
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope the joint's got the roof on tight. As always, we've got everyone's favorite. Here he is. His name,
Yeah, you better say my name and say it right, motherfucker.
Oh, yes, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Chris L.
That's right.
And I can't believe how good the opening of the show was. We should just play the end song now and be done with it. It's unbelievable.
Can you believe that voice acting performance?
I really can't. It was excellent stuff. So, obviously, you know, if you heard correctly, we have a fourth guest in the house today. Mr. 300 himself, Tom Cottle.
Hey, everyone. How's it going?
Wonderful, Tom. So let's just get it out right in the open, right off the bat. How many 300 games have you bowled in your life?
I don't remember. I think it's 11.
11.
11.
He doesn't
remember.
I think it's 11.
I think.
It's not that this important to him at this point.
It's unbelievable how matter of fact he is about that. I've never met anyone who's rolled a 300 game. Actually, that's not true. The proprietor of Maple Lanes, my home alley back in the day.
Back in Detroit?
East Detroit was a 300 game shooter. That's it. Him and Tom Cottle.
And Tom has 11.
I do.
Aren't you bowling professionally? The lifestyle?
No, lifestyle, it's too much, you know. Too much life on the road, you know.
Not into it. Yeah. Not everyone is...
But rolled 11 300 games on shitty public, you know,
Stardust has shitty public lanes. They do.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there's a guy who went to Knoll. I think he's like 50. He was like a year older than me. Like 50? How do you
50,
even do that?
300 games?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And he's not a professional bowler either.
No.
So it's just a lifestyle choice. And didn't you say it's also expensive?
To go pro?
You have to pay your own way.
So basically, if you don't win, you don't
get anything. Even if you win, it's not a lot of money. You're pretty much doing the regional circuit.
You got to become a star, quote unquote, in the bowling world.
It's just glory, pretty much, right?
Pretty much.
Just in pursuit of the status of being a professional.
What fun is that? Who wants to bowl 60 games a week?
The pressure would crush most people.
Yeah. I can imagine. I mean, me just bowling like a regular game at like noon on a Thursday. Not in a league.
That's a nice fresh oil pattern, though.
That's true. So I should have no pressure. I should be happy down there.
So it's episode 300. Yes. We have Mr. 300 here. Tom, what's your high series?
It is 8 19.
Okay, that's so episode 819, we'll have you back.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh my God. And I also would like to say that I never thought I'd live to see the day where I would see, or in this case, hear something that was even more homoerotic than the movie 300. The intro checked that box for me.
Wow.
Just the gayness just flowing out. Even more so than the original movie.
Hmm. See, I missed the original movie, but I know
we've never, never seen it.
Because
I know it's all about abs.
Right.
It's basically, it's an ab film.
Okay, you've never seen it. Have you seen it?
No, I've never seen it.
Have you seen it?
No.
Good.
keep it that way?
Right. If you've seen it, you might get a pass, but if you've seen it and you kind of enjoyed it, you are a homosexual.
Is that
it's
really
that
all
simple.
Is that all that's going on in the movie?
I don't know.
Or women? Women? Or not even?
No.
It doesn't appeal to them?
No. I mean, no, I did see the trailer about 10 times.
There's a woman in it. There's a guy behind her. like on top and behind her. I don't know.
The movie 300 is like a mosh pit. It's just gay. It's as simple as that. If you participate in either and you enjoy either, you're a homosexual. There's nothing wrong with that, but it's just a true statement about yourself.
It's not like there's anything wrong with it.
No.
That's nice for daddy.
Tom, stop trying to skip the struggle. You know, Tom brought snacks that expire in a couple weeks.
Wow.
Chips expire?
Still has the original price. No,
there's no clearance.
No, actually, orange clearance tag. That's what Tom brought.
Actually, those snacks don't have an expiration date. They have an exhaustion date.
Hell yes. Shit.
Tom brought over some wrap snacks, which I've heard of before.
I've never even heard or seen.
Never been in a place that actually carried them.
And it's right down the street.
Yep.
Wow.
You have access to these until what? 10 o'clock.
I think it's 11.
Is it 11?
On a daily basis now. And they're selling alcohol now, which is great news.
That's trash.
Yeah. Great news for the neighborhood. Went from snacks to alcohol. Whatever.
Nothing like having Dickie Poncho having that access.
Don't they sell knives over there, too? There was a big controversial thread on the What's Up Monster Facebook page that some old lady was aghast that they were selling, like, small knives.
Like pocket knives or something? Oh, I didn't even notice that.
It's like a big, nice Chicago cutlery set, you know? I mean, they had gala apples for $1 a piece.
Oh, geez. A piece?
In like
I'll be back in like 10 minutes.
A foil little roasting pan.
What?
Up at the counter.
They're really raising their game.
Did they core it and put like brown sugar and cinnamon?
They did not.
Did they do something nice like that?
What's a gala apple anyway? Trash.
Is that a bad one? I don't know my apples.
Yeah, I don't even know what.
Gala's garbage.
Gala's pretty common.
Are you
common folk?
Are you
no
more
idea.
More of a pink lady guy?
Pink lady, Honeycrisp.
Like I said about the opening. And it's only getting worse or better, depending on your perspective.
I didn't say a pink man apple.
Tom wants a pink lady immediately.
Man apple.
Several pounds of pink lady. That's what Tom wants.
So here we are, huh? 300. We made it. We did it. Special and spectacular.
Congratulations, you three.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. So much congratulations is needed and deserved.
I'm glad we didn't try to skip the struggle.
We never would.
We never did.
We went through the struggle. There were some episodes that no one listened to. That's not true. But there was definitely a struggle. Not that we're cleaning it up or anything now, but steady uphill trajectory for us so far. So that's good. Feels good to be doing this. I don't know. 300. There we go. As a commemorative item, we're selling beautiful Pot of Thunder pins over on potofthunder.com with that logo you see right now. Oh, look at that. Things of beauty. Tom's got his on. Tom,
do.
They probably didn't even make you pay for that stuff when you went to the convenience store.
Because I was wearing the pin?
Yeah. Well, they know. They know who we are. We're right down the street.
That's true.
We're like the neighborhood boys.
But he did make
of.
Me pay, so maybe I should go try to get a refund.
Go slap him around.
We're like Frankie Valli and his friends.
Basically.
Yeah.
When we're not podcasting, we're around a garbage can singing doo-wop. I mean, Nick and Chris.
How great would that be?
Yeah. Yeah, everyone knows us. Just the neighborhood
he
guys.
He sounds so excited.
He does.
Come on.
Chris would be
give me a few
that.
Bars.
That's not it. For free. Come on.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. We're done doing stuff for free other than putting out these episodes, selling merchandise,
cash,
charging for our singing.
That reminds me of a Huey Lewis story.
Okay, let's hear it.
Went to see Huey Lewis. It was probably over 10 years ago at this point. Star Plaza.
Mm-hmm.
And some lady had her phone out and was trying to get his attention in between songs. And he's like,
to get a picture?
What's going on? She said, I don't know if it was her husband or her friend or somebody. It was their birthday. Can you sing happy birthday? So he took the phone. He hung up. He goes, look, I'm professional. I get paid to do this. I'm not. Wow. Not
at a
into
Huey
it.
Lewis concert.
At the concert, he took the phone from the lady, hung up, and said, "Look into the microphone. I'm a professional. I get paid for this."
He should have done a glansy of his giant schwanz, reputed to have one of the hugest tools in rock and roll.
Really? Is that right, Huey Lewis?
Absolutely.
Oh, he should have been in 300, the original. Just saying.
Hey, it would have worked if
he also would have been a judge of the talent show in 300 as well, coincidentally enough. You guys not getting that?
I have no idea.
Never heard that rumor.
Back to the Future?
Oh, okay.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Man.
Was there a talent? There was a talent show.
Was that it, the talent show?
Yeah.
That's what I thought.
With Chuck Berry's cousin.
Right.
Well, that's later.
And then I think Little Richard's cousin, Diminutive Andrew, was there at the talent show. Oh,
Jesus.
Tanned boy.
Yeah.
Naturally tanned.
Yeah.
They never showed who won. It came down to the wire. Marty McFly and Diminutive Andrew.
Yeah.
Crowd blown away.
What a ridiculous show so far.
Yeah. We better get to the point before people just cut this off.
No shit.
Although if it's a potent song and people see it in the title, they will sit through this crap.
They'll be hitting the 15-second forward button repeatedly.
As I would recommend that,
Well, whose choice is it this week? I can't remember.
It's Nick, of course.
Nick. Okay.
Goodness.
Nick.
Talk about pressure. I feel like I'm a pro bowler.
Is that because it's episode 300? It has some significance?
No, it doesn't have any significance.
It has none whatsoever. Okay.
I don't know if that's an expectation. Yeah. And what happened to Pete Weber's sunglasses after he hit that strike? Did you notice they were no longer on
him? Spiked them down to the ground.
We don't see what happened.
Long gone.
He didn't need them anymore. He was done with the game. He gets that ultraviolet look at the pins. And
I guess.
Lets him zero in on the target.
Like Iron Man.
So, before you tell us what the song is this week, do you want to give us any insight, any
it's pretty
background before we get to it?
It's pretty simple, really.
Yeah, and again, everybody else knows the song except for those of us in this room, except for Nick. Considering who is here, there's an obvious presumption, at least of the band. I don't know if it's going to be that if it would be
obvious.
That obvious with it, but we'll see, because there is some material from this band on the list.
Yeah,
and this is a list pick. This is not.
Yeah,
I'm thinking back to back Sabotage.
Pick. Yeah,
this is.
Are there more than one Sabotage?
There's
on the list?
Four, I think.
Oh boy.
Yeah,
this one came from Mr. Matt Adamson. He submitted it.
Matt Adamson. Did he leave any? Well, I guess we don't want no comments.
He didn't leave any comments.
Okay.
He knew he must have known he submitted a winner. So
okay. Nothing needed
it
to
was,
be said.
It was just, it's a song where when I looked through the list, it very simply caught my attention. A song that I know and a song I like very much. Mm-hmm. And that's it, really. Just I saw it and it was one of those where I'm like, oh yeah, I'd like to listen to that song right now.
Matt Adamson saw the comments about the song section and he said,
what can you say about...
Yeah. All right. Why not? Tom, stop making eye contact with me. I'm not used to making eye contact. We basically all just look at the floor
like
when we do the show.
Like I said, he set the tone.
Yeah, he did.
Early on.
I get on my phone.
There you go. I'm more comfortable if everyone's on their phone.
Tom's not looking at his phone.
I'm not.
Oh, man.
I'm just going to gaze into your eyes. Little Nick and Chris talk.
Me and Chris are going to share some of these inspirational chips.
All right. So, are you ready for us to play the introduction clip? You ready for this?
Yeah, let's just do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is time to turn the microphone over to Chris Jericho.
All right, Harold. This one's called
Stiff Competition.
Off of
Heaven Tonight.
By the band
Cheap Trick.
All right, I gotta say, not familiar. Chris, you?
What album is this from?
Heaven Tonight.
Yeah, I gotta admit, I've never heard
the
this one.
The one that Surrender is the opener.
Okay, wow. Yeah, I had Budokan, of course, and I had Dream Police. That was pretty much it. I didn't get In Color or Heaven Tonight or the.
Those are the two that I
self-titled
have.
Debut.
So Chris has two previous ones. And then
no, he has two later ones. I have the second and third albums. I enjoy Cheap Trick quite a bit. Not that huge to where I'm buying a lot of albums, but very much enjoy those two.
Yeah, it was the same way. I had the two that I mentioned, and I eventually got. I think Standing on the Edge was. One that I used to round out my 15 Columbia House albums once, and it was pretty good. But yeah, never really owned a ton of Cheap Trick other than the staples, of course, being Budokan and Dream Police, both outstanding albums, mm-hmm. of course.
Tom, where are you at with Cheap Trick?
The only one I have is Budokan. I'm not familiar with this song as well, but I do enjoy Cheap Trick, you know. Remember that one year they came to Festival of the Lakes?
Did they?
I think it was like 99 or something.
Oh, really?
That would have been before Joan Jett was there.
Hammond Summer Festival. They might have been the same year as Davy Jones.
Oh, I missed it.
I think that was 99. I wish I was.
Andy's talked up that performance so
much. I think it was at the point, you know, now we've got
Magnetic
the big stage.
Between
I think they're playing
songs,
in the beer garden.
So.
Yeah?
Think that
he was
captivating
performer. A lot of flirting with women, basically a lot of winking and cheeky British
Absolutely.
Phrases directed at the
I
women in
I
the audience.
Wish I would have gone to that. I don't know what I was doing that night.
You were blowing it.
You're gonna be in trouble.
I could tell you this.
No, that was before.
The women of Hammond wanted an explosion that night when
they did.
He was done performing. Whipped him into a frenzy.
Women of all races and creeds.
That's right.
They all had to jump into the lake
to cool off.
Yeah, just it's like a
How
steam
long ago
coming
was
out.
This?
99.
Okay,
yeah,
so he was
like
still had some energy. Was youthful.
He was basically like Austin Powers in real life. Like the look and the behavior was basically
the moves,
everything.
Too?
Yeah.
Man, how did I? Miss that.
So Cheap Trick is the second loudest concert I've ever seen.
Is
and I've seen Slayer and Motorhead. Neither of them are number one.
Oh, I thought Slayer was one. No?
No, not in terms of sheer volume. Number two, Cheap Trick, Harpo's in Detroit.
How big is Harpo's?
It's probably a little smaller than the Metro.
Oh, it's small.
Yeah.
So okay. Around what year was that?
That had to have been... I think it was the Standing on the Edge tour, so it was like 87, 88.
Was it a
like
special
that.
Thing, or was that all the seats they were selling at
that
point? That
was pretty much
really?
the circuit they were playing at the
That's
time.
That's like 1,000 people,
but
probably.
But they brought their backline and sound system for the larger venue, and
right.
it was
wow.
fucking loud in there.
Wow.
So, but it was a good show.
Who's the number one loudest?
You'll never guess in a million years, so I'm just going to tell you.
Davy Jones, The Cult.
Midnight Oil
okay.
at St.
Oh
Andrews
my.
Hall in Detroit,
wow.
another venue of a similar size. That was painfully loud. I mean, I was wow. actually experienced physical pain from the volume off of those guys.
I felt that
wasn't when expecting that at all.
Was this when Beds Are Burning was the big
yeah,
thing?
Yeah, it was 87, 88, another college era show.
I felt that way when Nick and I went to a monster truck rally when we were younger.
Oh, yeah.
I couldn't believe the volume.
Yeah.
It's unacceptable to me. I had to go in the hallway and cover my ears.
Yeah, that was at Rosemont, I think.
Yep.
The whole building was shaking.
I was like, this is unsafe for humans. But I was probably, what, like 8, yeah. 9? But yeah.
Oh, you didn't have the big headphones on like all the kids have nowadays?
No, I think I got, either bought or whoever we were with, the parents of our Nick's friend who took us. I think they gave us the little foam ones you put in your ears, but that still didn't work.
No.
But yeah, okay. Midnight Oil.
That's not the song today.
give you guys 20 guesses. Would you ever come up with that?
No.
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 No. No.
And
no one, literally no. No one would guess that.
And the guy from Midnight Oil wouldn't have guessed it.
He wouldn't have been able to hear the question. That's how loud their shows were.
Neither would Huey Lewis. He's deaf now. All right, let's move on.
Yeah.
Still has a huge penis, but.
Yeah, so. It's in his ear.
The singer from Midnight Oil resembled a penis from the neck up. So
that's right.
There's your connection.
Shaved head.
I right thought when I saw the AC/DC Live at Donington video.
You thought the drummer I thought the drummer Peter
was
Garrett.
Guy from Midnight Oil. Well,
that's pretty cool.
Could have happened.
Around.
Two gigs.
Kind of like when the singer of Racer X became the drummer of Badlands. How did this happen?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, it's not the same guy. In that case, it was.
It was the Stacy Jones of the 80s.
Yeah. Multi-talented individual. Andy and I saw Cheap Trick once.
Well, you saw Cheap Trick. I was there.
Oh, well, whatever. Yeah.
I was in the concession.
What does that mean?
I was in the concession line.
Andy was miles away.
almost the entire time of the Cheap Trick set.
At Lollapalooza in 86.
Getting some Sprites or whatever we were getting. But yeah, they were performing while we were extremely far away. Our mom and me, and then Nick and our friend Jared.
Yeah, we were really
in the pit of Cheap Trick.
Really close up for when Joey Ramone came out and sang "Surrender" with them.
Yeah. Oh wow. Yeah. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it was some cool stuff.
That was
way cool.
That was hometown Rockford show. They weren't on that tour, were they?
No, they just played the Rockford
jumped in
area show.
For the Rockford show.
Yeah, and it's a band that I've never really understood until fairly recently. Or I don't know that I do, but I appreciate them more than I ever had because there's a bit of it's hard to tell when they're being sincere and when they're being sarcastic. And I like that.
Yeah, the whole like the visual image, the shtick, and you nailed the description. It's like, are these guys clowning or are they serious? In general, though, you just focus on the music. You can tell they're pretty effing serious. Pretty incredible band, no question about it.
So truth be told, I never have given them a chance. Never hated them, just never listened.
You never listened to Budokan?
Never.
Oh.
I've heard,
well,
obviously, like
two
or three songs on the radio over and over my whole life, which... You know,
well,
this isn't
songs.
One of them.
No,
so.
No, it's not. But just with any of those bands, after you hear it a million times, you start to almost resent them.
This is a pretty deep cut.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Budokan is right up there with either of the Kiss live albums from the 70s. It's that iconic.
I know SOD live at Budokan.
I have that cassette still.
Is that
when
even
Billy Milano had to stop because he had to let one go into the microphone? I don't know. That's the kind of
classic moment. Is that even actually in Budokan, or is that like
I think
is that
so.
Just the title because they're making a reference to Cheap
Life
Trick?
Life at the outskirts
probably.
Of Budokan.
But the thing about Cheap Trick, which you give them credit for, is they were one of the few, possibly the only. Band to put out a iconic live album that didn't have the word live or alive in the title. It's simply Cheap Trick at Budokan. Very cool take on it. So if SOD, is it SOD at Budokan?
Great question. I always thought it was live, but I haven't. Nick had the cassette tape 25 years ago or whatever it was. I don't even know.
I'm looking it up as we speak.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, I'm assuming they put live in there because they missed out on the nuances.
It is live at Budokan.
Right, there you go. They're a bunch of clods. Completely missed the nuance, and that's good because they're not worthy of shining Cheap Trick's shoes.
Damn.
more of this punk rock bullshit that the Jones boys like.
You don't
it's
go
pure
for that
trash.
Shit. You don't go for that shit. Do you?
Shows you putting the word live in there, just and missing out on all the nuance.
And it was at the Ritz in New York, actually.
Yeah. See, I was right. Maybe I knew that and
pretty
forgot
funny.
It. And then just remembered.
Wow, real clever and funny, that's those like SOB.
I thought it was at the Muse Cafe.
Yeah, I wouldn't have booked this. Shitheads.
Shitheads.
Actually, I might have booked them. I needed a slot with the Flying Errands. And what crap can I put on with these guys?
Damn.
That's, wasn't it Carlos Live or something like that?
Carlos also featuring Live. Carlos. That's the greatest name ever, hopefully for a full band.
So his solo project was just called Featuring Carlos?
Yep.
You don't want to drop the featuring part.
No. Featuring Carlos is a good name, too. There was a Gwar Live album that was live at Mount Fuji, also not real. Live at also there was Live at Antarctica too, also not real, of course.
Oh, just clever, just amazingly funny people that Andy worships.
There's a hoot.
Yeah, just
everybody's chuckling.
The rapier wit of Gwar and SOD.
Hey man,
wow, what giants of entertainment. Multifaceted entertainers.
That's right.
Let's get at it.
People are he's just jealous because Gwar's bowled a 300 before.
Gore the dinosaur bowled an 840 series.
All right.
So you guys ready?
Yeah.
All right, let's do it.
Let's get fucking flying.
Stiff, right away.
And Huey. Some straight-ahead rock and roll right there.
It always made me think of like something that AC/DC could have, like a riff they would have had.
I could see
but
that.
But the drum groove would have been different a little bit.
You know, that guitar riff kind of reminded me of Larger Than Life a little bit.
Ooh.
The intro.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Similar tone, a pretty closely connected riff there. That's what that reminded me of.
And they also are boner anthems. At least I'm guessing this one is. I mean, what else would it be about?
I mean, the innuendo is obvious. Yeah. But, yeah, I mean, this is, again, when Cheap Trick wanted to throw down, they absolutely could.
Yeah.
I mean, they were a potent band. You know, you have the whole thing about them when they were out, with the albums, with the good-looking guys on the front and the kind of quirky, dopey-looking guys on the back. You know, that was kind of the shtick.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, again, it was the pre-MTV days. They did put out a few music videos later on that started to make the circuit. But, you know, it was hard to make, get a read on these guys. It's like, are they serious? Yeah. Are they a joke band or whatever? 9 times out of 10, you put on the music, you realize this is not a joke. These guys are great rockers, great songwriters. And
and this is Rick Nielsen. I think he's the sole writer of this one.
Yeah, okay. But then you've already got Mr. Zander coming in with the strong vocals he's known for. What a great... great frontman vocalist, one of the top of all time.
Yeah, there's vocal moment a couple times he does it on this song that I'm amazed by every time I hear it.
Is it one of those that you
look for the hand gesture when it comes?
It'll happen.
Is it one of those things you try in the car and embarrass yourself? Glad that no one else heard
don't
it.
Even attempt it. Yeah.
Yeah.
First of all, give me a little more juice on the music. It's pretty...
It's kind of quiet.
We didn't do the Danzig sound check to start this off, so that's where we missed the boat on it. But
Secondly, yeah. What was the next part? Was there part two to that?
Part two to what?
Oh, you said first, give me some more volume. I thought you had a a comment on the song.
What I'm liking is the bass line where he hits those two really low notes as part of the riff. Again, Tom Peterson was known for the 12-string bass.
This, I think, is the first album that it appears on.
What is that, six with octave
strings?
No,
it's four with two octave strings on each one. But, you know, it doesn't really sound like that to me, especially those low notes. But I just like how he's throwing those in and it really is beefing up the sound.
Yeah.
That's what I'm keying in on so far.
What's going
on?
Oh,
my.
I screw you, you screw me.
What? They screw us. Here we go again.
Okay, so that could be, it could mean several things.
I've never understood exactly what the song is about. I mean, there's obviously like the tongue-in-cheek sexual kind of a road you can go down.
Right.
Or either that or it's capitalism.
Yeah, I mean, like you have competition in whatever field you're trying to get ahead in. Dog world.
I don't know.
Backstabbing, what have you.
Cutthroat work environment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
And that that vocal moment is coming up right after you hit play here.
All
right.
I'm ready for it. Oh, I'm not ready. What happened?
It was that first growl.
Oh,
that,
you just
that
like the growl?
That all right.
Oh, okay.
How strong his voice is the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
And then when he finishes off and says the word, says the right, then it's like even stronger somehow.
That's an interesting thing to key in on because I was...
You were thinking it was going to be like
I
a really high thing.
I was expecting it was going to be a high thing.
No, really low and powerful. Yeah. And then we got a little breakdown here, which is pretty cool. A little...
1 minute in, you think, if it was a typical whatever rock song, you would save a breakdown for later in the
song.
Yeah,
you probably wouldn't have a little arpeggio, cleaner guitar sound going on here. But right after, I don't even know if you'd consider that a chorus. What we had gotten.
Have you ever heard of a live version of this song?
Yeah, I think...
It seemed like it would have been a pretty impressive run for him to do.
I've seen videos. Live. Yeah, there are videos from this era of them doing this. So it's a deep cut, but it's not one that they completely, ignored, as far as I know. Again, not being an expert on all things Cheap Trick, but just very much enjoying this song in this era, so...
Anything lyrically that we've missed? Or are we good so far?
I don't. There's not. There's really not a whole lot to it from what I've read in the past of the lyrics. Cause it's not. It didn't come with the CD that I have.
Yeah.
So it's just. Yeah, I don't know. Just stiff competition.
And they said, "I go up if you take." Oh wait, I go up. You take me higher.
Yeah, and so it's like I don't know.
That ain't capitalism.
It could be.
It could be, but that ain't capitalism there.
Probably not.
That's
boner talk.
It's about momentum of some sort.
Oh, boner stuff.
Making an already large boner even larger.
Yeah.
It's the 1% of boners, right?
He's a 1%er.
We're going to call it a Huey.
Well, that's 0.1%. That's rarefied air.
The sound that it makes when it swings by.
Yeah, exactly.
what was that sound?
Whiffs by your ear.
Did he say something about dirty bumping in there?
No.
I don't think I heard.
I don't even know. I have no idea what he said. Is that, I looked hard in your eyes? Was that the part?
No.
Waiting for your turn.
What the fuck?
I heard the phrase dirty bumping in there.
Maybe don't we don't need to look up. Maybe we can just accept that. This could be like...
I can't even pinpoint where it was, but I heard it. It
could be like the Love Drive episode where we just said, okay, it's fine. It's my whore's got wings.
Just leave it as is.
That's what we want to hear.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
Wasn't that the one on the YouTube? The lyrics?
Yeah.
Someone actually typed that on the someone's lyric video.
Someone commented on that episode. I remember, come on, guys. It's my heart's got wings. None of us had thought at all that it could be anything other than
my whore's got wings. Well, that's the way it should be. I don't know.
So dirty bumping it is.
Dirty bumping. I like that better than whatever was said.
Take that, Rick.
But the that breakdown with the acoustic guitar has almost got a making love type breakdown feel. Yeah.
And there's a bit of an acoustic kind of a feel to even when we're in the throes of the heavy rocks passage. It's got a little bit of that, and what was I gonna say? Lost it. Never mind. I'll say it later if I think of it.
That kind of had a Dave Mustaine vibe to it.
Yeah.
Obviously, this is pre-Mustaine, but...
Good point.
Little gritted teeth. Every day of my life.
Did Mustaine take any... cues from Cheap Trick at all? Cheap Trick seems to be a band that's universally respected by bands of all across the spectrum. Super heavy bands, poppy bands. Everybody respects these guys.
Yeah, that's true. I'm sure he was a fan at some point.
I mean, Jakey Lee got him on his first Red Dragon Cartel album.
Right,
got
that
Robin
was a
Zander.
nice choice. But I just think that This album was what, 78?
78, yeah.
I just think that's when a lot of the iconic rockers of the 80s were coming up, and I guarantee you they all were at Budokan. So it would make sense that they would consume some of the studio albums for the deeper cuts, and I'd be surprised if Xander didn't influence a lot more people than you might expect.
And I think musically, it's pretty cool how we're getting the tambourine. I know we have the tambourine controversy with Andy, but he's explained it many times. It's not. It's more in a performance, a visual aspect that it can annoy him.
Yeah.
But it's a good groove and it works. And then there's the other heavy part where there's a wood block or a cowbell going on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's some good use of that stuff and it's all effective.
Yeah, this is definitely one that it wasn't on Budokan. Maybe it was on the expanded version.
It could
I don't
be.
Know. But this is one that you just can picture them just bringing the house down they pulled it out in a live setting.
There's
this high energy, great vocal. The guitars are aggressive. Got that little breakdown, which might make for some interesting. Live textures or whatever, but when they put the pedal to the metal, it's a full tilt rocker, no question.
And don't leave out when we're featuring Bun E. Carlos.
Oh yeah, outstanding.
Bun E. featuring Carlos.
Yeah, there you go. But again, the guy he's got looks like the guy from the accounting pool. Who lights up a cigarette and has a seat behind the drums and proceeds to kick everybody's ass. It was just such a unique image. I can't think of anybody who was doing anything even remotely similar to this. It was just, it's almost like the Kiss thing where it's like, how much of it was contrived? How much of it did they stumble upon by accident and they kept at it? But this whole bit with the two dreamy Tiger Beat type guys and then the two dorks, it was just like, you were, you know, in the days of the record stores, you'd pick up the album, you'd look at this like, what the fuck is this? And it would draw you in to buy it and listen to it. And if you were into rock music, when you consumed the music, you were hooked.
You came back for more, definitely.
Absolutely. But this image was unlike anything else that was going on, or even anything else I can think of since. Very unique.
And Rick Nielsen, during this era, the expressions and some of the motions he would make on stage when he was like doing the, you know, hyper spaz kind of a routine, mm-hmm. Reminds me of a young Rick Mayall, the old British comedian from the Young Ones and Drop Dead Fred and all that.
Sure.
Very, very similar look and like the motions and the expressions. I think there's a, I mean, I don't know that there's any influence one way or the other, but just
I could see it
always
now.
Reminded me of a young Rick Mayall when I see old footage of Rick Nielsen.
Well, I thought Rick Nielsen was somewhat influenced by Hunts Hall. I thought there was a little of that going on. I remember maybe reading that somewhere. I have no idea. But again, very unique image for him and the whole band.
One of the lyrics, I think.
Did you say "dirty bumping" again?
I don't know, but it
waiting
was
waiting for your turn.
It took me minutes. And you're still waiting for your turn. Mm. Pretty sexual.
Yeah,
it's boner talk.
Fits into the Rick Nielsen like nerd kind of a, you know.
He's a bad lover.
Yeah, basically.
He's a nerd,
right? I mean.
Premature ejaculation.
Well, it's a thing. It's like he's almost using that as like ammunition against the woman. It's like you're not shaming me. You just it came in your pants within 10 seconds. Why would I feel inferior to you? Is basically the attitude. But that's a pretty pretty potent way of putting it there.
I wonder if that's got anything to do with the rest of the song. Or if that's just an isolated lyric.
Yeah, it does seem like it doesn't really go with the rest of the lyrics. You're right.
I think they're shucking and jiving, going in all sorts of directions that could, be applicable to the song title.
I think you're right.
And or the dirty bumping lyric in the first breakdown. It was there, I'm
it
telling
was there.
You.
We're just I'm accepting
go back and listen to it.
And if it's not on this website we're looking at, it's bad lyrics because it's there.
Well, somebody sent us a better website, but we're still not using it, apparently.
What was it? I don't know what
it
was.
I don't know. Somebody sent it.
No. I'll find it for the 2025
but
episodes.
Any, lyrics? Any site that doesn't have the phrase dirty bumping in it for these lyrics, not a good site. I'm telling you, it's there. Yeah, go back and listen to it.
That's just such a...
Maybe this is an alternate version of the song.
Of Dirty
Bumpin'. Dirty Bumpin' mix.
Oh, and then the lyrics.
The Dirty Bumpin' mix.
Yeah.
The live version.
Yeah.
It's so loud, you can't make out the lyrics, but...
Say whatever you want live.
Telling you, go back and listen to it. It's there.
You know, what are the odds that we're talking about some kind of boner song today?
When you had one earlier?
I have one the whole time we're sitting here. That's why I have my leg up here covering my lap. No,
it's those soft pants.
I don't have those right now.
Andy had one of those work erections.
So
just
What? Just there at work and all. Just whoops.
Sudden, like what are you, 15?
Like a boy, yeah. uncontrollable.
I mean, it was understandable where we used to work. Now, not so much.
Not so much. So I'll quickly tell you guys a story from today, but I think you might find some entertainment in this. So I work for this video production company, and an assignment that we took for next week was to film boner surgery.
He told me about this.
So they sent a sample of a slightly different previous version of this exact same surgery. So through my fingers and squinting, I looked at it while some other people were watching it because I am squeamish. Even if it wasn't a boner thing, just any kind of surgery, I'm not good at looking at that stuff. But anyway, so it's they put an inflatable in your shaft to help cure erectile dysfunction.
Like a stent.
So obviously, when I hear this, I'm thinking like, well, how does it pump and release? That's like my first question. So I'm like making jokes. Oh, it's like a basketball and you got to get a pump and go whatever. But as we're watching it, one of the jokes I made, I'm like, oh, maybe it's like a Reebok pump. It's like a Reebok pump. Oh, they put like a third ball inside your scrotum that's a pump. So when you want to pump up your wiener, you squeeze your balls.
There's got to be a better way.
Right. And then there's a...
How old was this video? When was this surgery? Like
well, they're
76?
Asking, but they're asking him to make a new video for the same technology.
Yeah, there's something... I'm sure it's like slightly different, but it's the same technology. And to release, there's a button on it. Like...
Is there like a PSI threshold where it won't go above it?
I would be afraid that you'd burst it.
Some sort of digital...
Because you can't just...
There's got to be some sort of warning.
You can't just
like, warning,
out.
Warning.
Why not just get something on the outside at that point? Just wear something...
What if you're at work and you just kind of like, you know, you're crossing your legs during a meeting and you accidentally pump up your... You know,
that's what Andy's doing right now.
Something gets squeezed.
It's like, how do you explain that on a first date? Both the pumping and the air release. It's like you're not getting a second date after that. You're a fucking weirdo.
I mean, when you're doing that, who's pumping it? Are you
that's
pumping
true.
It?
Well, maybe.
Are you going to let the lady pump
maybe
it?
Maybe it's part of foreplay.
I mean, that would be right. Part of foreplay.
And that
would,
that's kind of
my balls.
That's kind of similar, you know.
Well, yeah, sure.
Squeeze my balls, I get an erection.
Yeah. Squeeze my balls, pump my dick.
That's not unheard of.
Right. I don't know about
so
you
so this
guys.
Is almost simulating a normal process.
Yeah, but the release is strange.
The release kills it, you know.
What if it's like when you release a balloon and it goes in every direction across the room? And I don't know about you guys, but every single thing that I own that inflates with air, there's a leak in it.
Right.
Everything.
Oh, yeah.
Every
odds?
Tire that I have, bicycle, motor vehicle, whatever.
There's a leak.
Everything has a leak in
there's
it. Gotta,
football there's got to be a better way.
Yeah, and like there's nothing you can do.
Does it come with a patching kit?
<That's
right>. Some Gorilla glue and a...
Right, you can't do anything about it. No, you got to get a surgery if it's leaking.
That has got to be an absolute last resort. I mean, does this guy have any customers?
Great question. I have no clue.
That's just terrible.
Are you putting some sort of merchandise on advertising disc. Spin in this video, too?
I'm trying to get them to hold a Pot of Thunder pin up in front of the guy's schlong as it's being pumped up. As long as it's sanitized, I think we can squeeze it in there.
It's just
maybe
terrible.
Maybe drop it in the balls when
you
sew it up.
Literally, literally an absolute last resort. And even then, it's like...
I would just say forget it.
Yeah.
Who cares?
Just
find something else to do.
Just be really fucking good at cunnilingus. Then you don't need an erection. You don't ever have to have one.
Just take up golf like everyone else who can't get a boner. Isn't that the point of the game?
Pretty much.
A
pool you watch. You watch golf. You see ads for lumber pills and investment companies.
That's pretty much it.
Yeah.
Wealthy guys with soft penises.
Yeah.
That's the audience.
Stress, right? I mean, isn't it in both cases?
Yeah. Maybe that's
it's stress.
Maybe you just need to change your line of work. Instead of getting a dick surgery,
just have
the Reebok pump installed
the
in your boner.
The business end of the tongue of a Reebok pump put in your ball sack. Who would do that? I mean, it's just
could you save
terrible.
Some money and refurbish an old pair of your Reeboks and be like, I've got the pump. Can you just put
you're refurbishing yeah, your
own. Can I save a little money by providing my own pump?
BYO pump. You're using it surgery. To refurbish an old something else. So.
Yeah.
Can you opt to have the pump put in your asshole and
I was thinking
get the stink finger working for you? That's another thing that would work normally. It's a little more out of the way that way.
See, or it could be the release.
Although every
mechanism.
Every time you took a shit, you'd get an inflatable erection.
Well, what else is what would be different about that?
You'd have a
good point. Excellent point.
You'd have a Pete Weber type orgasm while you're sitting on the toilet.
You can't believe it.
Yeah.
Who are you? What? I am.
So you're all defiant about it, yelling at people.
Yeah.
I can't imagine that your client has any fucking customers.
I have no. I mean, there's one, whoever's in the video, who probably got a deal for letting them film
it. It's like the CPAP mask of erection remedies. We can't do better than a fucking apparatus that makes you look like the guy in Alien.
Right.
Who got fucking smothered over the face by that thing. This is our cure for snoring and sleep apnea.
Then you go out of town and you got to have your own suitcase for this
thing?
That's
what I'm saying.
That's going to cost you $50 each way to fly somewhere.
Thanks, technology.
What a load of shit.
No shit. It's like... we got to do better than this, science people.
Yet at the same time... you could walk into the new Amazon Go store and not deal with any register and walk out, and it knows exactly what you took somehow.
Right.
Which I don't fucking understand. And I watched like 30 minutes of videos trying to explain it, and I don't know how they know what I put in my bag and put back, and it's right as I'm doing it. It's so weird.
Is it even if you like something without a label or what?
So you've been in there?
Have you been
in
one?
I go there every day.
Yeah. I haven't been in one yet.
It opened like 2 weeks ago at work.
Oh, so you do this.
I do it all, and I'm amazed by what's happening. I don't understand. You use an app to get into the store. You take whatever you want, and you leave. You don't scan it anywhere. You can put it in your backpack.
And it's always accurate.
It's always accurate.
So if you take like two bananas, three apples, and an orange,
well, they don't,
none of which may have a barcode or anything on it.
Well, they don't have those items.
Yeah,
so maybe
Nick, see,
Nick's trying to trick the system.
Exactly.
But it's like
he thinks it's a fucking farmer's market.
He's going to go in there and thinks he's going to get an SOD cassette. Jeez.
Well, you're taking things off the shelf, so it's like... it's like a convenience store, but I guess they would have apples and bananas there. But the things they have are more like it would be like two apples in a plastic container,
in a bag with a sealed thing.
It has to be something scannable.
I guess I'm trying to skip
but
the struggle.
I don't think they scan anything. It's all done through cameras that recognize you and see what you're doing, but there's no one telling it what to do. There's hundreds of cameras in the ceiling that know who you are when you walk in from you scanning the app. It's so weird, man. I don't get it. But yet
you're there every day.
Well, I think it's awesome, and it's reasonable.
It's awesome.
It's way cheaper than everything else around there,
terrifying.
Too.
Is it?
Yeah, because there's no one that really works there.
Do they have, like, sandwiches and stuff like that?
Yeah. But yet they have this, but we have to put Reebok pumps in our boners.
That's what I'm saying, yes.
Exactly.
And take a CPAP machine on vacation.
Oh, and let us not forget... we've landed a motherfucker on the moon.
Yep.
We've sent
50 years ago.
We've sent a spaceship to fucking Pluto.
Right.
And you've got the tongue of a basketball shoe in your nutsack.
You know,
what is this?
Maybe we need Mr. Bezos to work on this pump thing.
Yeah. Apparently he has no issues in
absolutely
that area.
Not.
They have a camera that
had to have a wide angle lens for his glansy.
Has it been released, or is it just we know that it exists?
Who knows?
I was going to say, is there... I was wondering if you heard Huey Lewis rumors about that guy.
But that's the thing. That guy, you can't tell if it's a dick pic or a picture of his own head. I mean, you can't... it's like the guy from Midnight Oil. You can't tell the dick. You can't prove that's my dick. It's my head.
He does magic with cameras.
Exactly.
That's all you need to
know.
There
you go. It doesn't have to be his dick. All right. Back to this song.
It's like, those are my forehead wrinkles, okay? You can't prove they're not. Anyway,
I'm sweating profusely just out of the very top of my head.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, I had shoulders are hairy and wrinkled. Yeah, what's the problem?
I had a small accident with a hatchet as a boy on the top of my head. You know what? You gonna impugn me for that? Come on, I couldn't do anything about it.
All right.
Also hearing a lot of Townsend in those chords there.
It's, and
very similar guitar player to Townsend in that predominantly known for his rhythm playing, his chord work, the lead soloing is secondary, even third, fourth, fifth element of his playing.
Main songwriter.
Right. So very, very similar there. Again, I'm not as much of a Cheap Trick nerd as the guys on the Hamer Guitar Forum, but I'm sure Nielsen was heavily influenced by Townsend.
Have you guys been to his pizza place in Chicago?
I've been there once. Yeah.
Rick Nielsen?
Long time ago.
Is it Peace?
Yeah.
I think I've been there. I don't know.
Have you?
Yeah. I was there once. It was good.
No, I've not been there. It's good?
I haven't.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's a similar to the Tomato Bar style pizza.
Oh, it's like
that we Nick have is a big here. Fan.
It's not a Chicago style deep dish.
No, they Chicago cut, but it's
I mean squares.
Squares.
Who made
that's
that?
The, you I'm know,
not
that,
a
that's
fan
a,
of that.
That's a I never knew that until a few years ago that was such a thing.
I don't get that though. When you get the middle pieces that have no outer crust on there. Not a fan of
that. See,
those.
I like that, actually, but it...
Yeah, why?
No.
I don't know. I just,
you don't like crust?
Are you not a fan of the centerpieces?
Well? No, I go for the crust. Like, when we get Aurelio's, we're fighting over ends.
See, Aurelio's, I could go...
Yeah, the middle ones are always left to the end. No Aurelio's... Fuck with that.
I just grab a quarter of the pizza when I get Aurelio's right off the bat.
So basically, you just eat it as if it was a triangle. I mean, it's all the same, really, but it is
25% of the pizza, yeah.
It's more like steps...
Yeah, but I've heard that that's a...
it's like a Q-bert version of a triangle.
The Q-bert pizza.
I've heard that that's a thing with people, or like a regional thing. You cut this New York style? I want a Chicago cut.
Yeah.
Give me a break. Yeah, if you're going to raise a stink about that.
I don't even care if you don't cut my pizza. I'll be fine.
Serve to get your ass kicked.
I'll cut it at home.
Yeah, it doesn't make a difference to me how you cut it. I'll eat it.
I'll deal with it. Yeah. I prefer the pie cut. Though.
But I would never make a complaint. I would never voice a complaint.
I would never go on Yelp and complain about it, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's cut. You need to cut it yourself anyway.
I would give
do
it
a good job.
Yeah, that's true. They only cut through the cheese and not through the crust.
And what's that fucking plastic thing that they put in the middle? What does that do?
A little picnic table?
That's so that
what
the cheese
do?
Doesn't stick to the
top of the box.
To the box or the if it's a or wax never, paper
I,
kind
I
of a
never
thing.
I never knew that. For some reason, I thought it was to maintain the integrity of the slices somehow.
No. It was just
I never knew that.
It was a free table for all those little girls in their Barbie dollhouses.
Yeah, that's
never
true.
Knew
and
that.
Me.
Yeah, that's...
Actually, in a pinch, you could use that as a cock stent.
Why not?
Well, there was
wedge that thing under your balls and prop your dick up without having to put the tongue of a basketball shoe in your nutsack. What kind of solution is that? What's wrong with these people?
That's permanent.
It's Why ridiculous.
Not Why not just come up with some kind of temporary thing you put
like
on the outside?
You say it's permanent.
Well, I mean, isn't that the... What do you mean?
It's permanent enough.
Just came out of, it's permanent.
It's permanent enough.
Oh,
if you want it removed, you have to go in for more surgery.
It's permanent until it malfunctions.
Well, yeah, and but then you have to
just
get a
like
surgery.
Anything.
That's what I mean. Why can't you just get some
until
kind
you get
of
a leak?
Like a cage of sorts that you put over and it helps you
until
the cock cage.
Cock
remember
cage.
That?
Yeah. The cock cage was ahead of this technology.
Yeah. I mean, if that doesn't work,
you
again,
throw it in the garbage. You're done with it.
Yeah.
Start golfing.
Again, this shit has to be an absolute last resort that you would go down this road.
You think there's an option you can hook a like tube up to it and have it in your pocket and go like kind of like a little pump in your
pocket. So you don't have like to play with little, your balls to do it?
You know, be a little surprised.
Like a port,
but
you mean?
Ideally, the pants are off and on the other side of the room when you're needing this functionality, right?
Yeah, yeah. That's. I mean, I guess Tom wants public boners.
Now, Tom's going to get locked up. And in which case...
Who, R. Kelly?
In which case, he ain't going to want any boners. His own or anyone else's near him.
That's when you need the pump in the ass.
Yeah. My well, hey, you're going to get it. God.
Wow, speaking of R. Kelly, the
dirty bumping.
Dirty bumping.
Yeah, Market 300. Yeah.
All right.
All right, where are we at here?
We're rocking.
We're rounding third.
Rocking along.
Do we know of any notable covers of this song? This seems like a song that people would latch onto and want to cover.
I've seen one from the last couple of years. It was when David Letterman was still on the air, and he was having...
the last week?
Yeah, when he was having bands play all week.
Who was it?
Foo Fighters did this with Rick Nielsen, and Taylor Hawkins wore like the white suit and had the long blonde hair, and he was lead vocal on it, so they kind of did a visual homage.
I guess they
That's
did.
The only
they
one
do,
I can think
they
of.
They do a good job with it. It this was stuff, but it's just like, why them?
It was a good version, as overexposed as they are. I'd have to give them credit.
I need to get over my aversion to them in that area, but
it's difficult.
They're the only band that tries to do things like that.
It's
that,
true.
Of that level, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
They're the only
ones.
Was
it good, though?
Yeah, good version.
Yeah, they're good. It's just, I don't know. I don't want to go down that rabbit hole, but.
So did Taylor Hawkins play the drums, too?
No, Dave Grohl played the drums.
Dave Grohl played the drums.
Yeah, he just sang.
That's pretty cool. Good on them. This is a rocker for sure.
There you have it.
There it is. 3 minutes and 40 seconds. Track 9 of 11. Weird place for it.
Yeah. I mean, I guess as as catchy and, you know, rocking as it is, maybe they didn't think it was going to be, a single.
Right.
What else you got on that second side?
Oh, let me tell you, Tom. Assuming the side starts with 6. Taking Me Back.
It's a good one.
On the Radio.
Good one.
Heaven Tonight.
Classic one.
Stiff Competition. How Are You? I like the title of that. I don't know that song. And Eau Claire. Not like Wisconsin. Like a
the home of Menards.
But that might have been a play on that words, as Rockford is pretty close to the border up there.
That's true.
Could be.
Yeah. I can see that. It's a love song to that city. Where it looks like it's a love song to a woman. Maybe. Maybe not. I don't know. But, hey, Rockford, huh? That's always... I always thought that was a cool thing about Cheap Trick, that they're from a weird city. Not that Rockford is weird, but I mean, it's not like...
It's not weird to us, because, I mean, we've seen it all our lives.
Yeah.
Well, but they've never said, like, oh, we're from Chicago.
Right, which is what most
people... Where in Chicago? Mm-hmm. Rockford. Yeah. Okay, that's not Chicago. They never played that game, you know?
Because, I mean, if you were telling someone in the world where you're from, you would just say Chicago to make it easier. That's where you're going to fly to, so Chicago. You know what I mean?
I mean, that's probably what we do a lot, too. It's like, you're not even from Illinois. Well, do you want to tell me that? You want me to tell you that I'm from Hammond?
Right.
You don't know
what I'm talking
about.
Yeah, so you just say Chicago.
Just say the
so it's cool that they...
Yeah, but a lot of people also do it because they feel it gives them more cred.
Well, basically, whatever city I'm in is the best city in town. Which doesn't make sense.
Well, you know, you say you're from Indiana. There's only one place in Indiana, and that's Indianapolis.
Right.
They're like, well, don't you watch the Colts? No. No. We're not Colts fans.
No. Yeah.
Different time zone.
No. You don't get them on TV? I'm 25 minutes away from you guys. We get the same stuff on TV.
I live closer to work than you do.
Yeah.
And you live in the city.
Right. Yeah. I can get to work faster than you.
Yeah. Asshole. I hate you.
I remember one time there was a guy who was super angry. It was, I went to the fireworks display at the Taste of Chicago one year.
Yeah.
Got mono there somehow. Was real super sick afterwards.
Weird.
And there were like, I think they said it was 1.1 million people were there. Mm. And all trying to move at the same time.
Yeah, it's brutal.
And there was some guy who was like, I mean, I thought if there was ever a time where someone, there was going to be a full-on brawl, like in a subway, that it was going to be with this guy. Because there's, he was chastising, nobody was talking except for this guy, and he was very angrily chastising everybody, calling them suburbanites, and what are they doing here? And you move and stand over here, and we'll, you know, like ordering people around.
And what's the point of this story?
The point of the story is it's the whole thing with you don't live in the city.
Yeah, so get out of here.
Yeah, kind of a thing.
Oh, piss
you should have slapped
you
them.
Shouldn't be
you
here
kissed
if, you don't, if you don't live here.
A person clearly unclear on the concept.
Yeah. What a dickhead.
Just doesn't get it.
What a fool. What a jerk off.
It's like the Kiss fans who are pissed off that they're not playing all deep cuts on the End of the Road tour. It's like,
why would they do that?
Do you not, they do you not or they should do they should reconvene the Revenge era lineup and play non-makeup shows. What is wrong
you
with
should you? Have your internet taken away from you.
Well, you should have a lot of things taken away from you.
This
your freedom, possibly your life.
Well, this is the final tour, right? Are they still going to plan on doing cruises?
Yeah, there's one.
That's what those are for. Go to the cruise.
But even then, they don't even go super deep.
Well, then you know
kind of do. But
if you've got a real problem with it, start a tribute band and play the songs with your friends.
Yeah, see how many people show up.
Well, that too. But if you really want to hear it, play it in your garage and shut up and get off the internet.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
You're ridiculous fools.
All right. So who votes first, Nikki, for picking it?
I'll go first. Yeah, it's a, what are we doing now? Sweet
time
surrender.
Time to vote, Sweet Surrender, kick in the crotch.
To use the hit song.
Track one.
Track one, a hit song, Sweet Surrender.
It's Sweet Surrender. Hell yes.
a song I did not know until I got the album. And immediately first listen was like, okay, this, like, there's just so many things about it that triggered enjoyment
specifically this
within
song
me. Yeah, this song specifically, this was one of those, like, some songs grow on you when you're listening to the album, but then there are the songs where they're not hits, and the first time that you're cycling through the album to kind of see what it's about,
mm-hmm.
there are those songs that just immediately everything about it, you're like, okay,
yeah,
that one did it for me.
Yep.
Like, and then you feel validated in your purchase immediately.
That's the best.
Because
yeah.
there's a song you enjoy that much. That's this song on this album.
Right.
Just everything about it. I think it's a great, great rock song. Some great little breakdown parts. Just everything that, like, the bass, there's some really cool parts there. Vocals are incredible. And all together, you know, fantastic song. So, and I don't, yeah, nothing else to say. There's just, everything about it is great, in my opinion.
Tom?
Ooh, I get a vote.
Of course.
Of course you do.
Sweet Surrender.
Oh.
It's Sweet Surrender! Hell yes.
Hell yes. Yeah, that was, it never ceases to amaze me that, I always forget about Cheap Trick, and that they are such an underrated band. Robin kicked this one out of the park. It was very good. Yeah. He was all over the place. It was really, really good. And it didn't stop. Though those couple breakdowns, which I like, but it was move forward. It was good.
You'd be a good show opener.
It would definitely be a good show opener. Live show. I'm surprised it's not on Budokan.
It might, like Chris said earlier, I think there might be an expanded edition.
There's definitely an expanded edition.
Be on there because
I'm not familiar with.
I've looked it up before, and I know that there's footage from that era of them playing it, so it's entirely possible.
It just maybe was left on the floor in the compilation.
Yeah, I guess. But didn't speaking of Robin Zander and his superiority vocally. Didn't Rick Nielsen used to wear a shirt sometimes that said, "My singer is better than your singer"?
Something like that.
I think. Good. Or something similar to that.
That's cool. I like that. Chris?
Sweet Surrender for me, for sure.
It's Sweet Surrender! Hell yes!
What's all the thrusting of the a lot jerking happening. Of limbs going on
so
over here.
Mine started with trying to get blood back into my leg, and then my knee popped.
And then Tom started copying me.
So also, out of the corner of my eye, I just see his flashing feet everywhere.
Also, based on the socks in this room, Tom and I like to have a good time.
Yeah,
Chris and Nick are meat and potatoes kind of guys.
Mine don't even match.
Yeah,
I don't even care.
They're both white. They don't match somehow. I don't know how you pulled that off.
The gray is not consistent.
Oh, boy. I'm actually somewhat ashamed to say I'd never heard this song before this episode. I never delved further back into the Cheap Trick catalog, but this is I got to agree with Nick, instant classic for me. I mean, this is like some potent rock and roll. On par with the stuff I like most off the Dream Police album, some of the more rocking, pretty much that whole album rocks. And this could fall right into it, because I know I've heard the studio version of I Want You to Want Me, and that's off the first album.
That's the second one. That's In Color, yeah.
Okay. It almost seems like Cheap Trick had the similarity to Kiss, whereas like the first couple studio albums, they were finding their way, a little tentative, not as potent as this, and then the live album. So it's like they kind of picked up steam as they went along. This is fully formed as you want the band to be. Pretty outstanding.
Andy?
Sweet Surrender.
It's Sweet Surrender.
Cheap Trick is one of those bands, for whatever reason. I've never spent the time. I don't want to say given the chance, because that makes it seem like I was like against it. It's just I've never. We didn't own any Cheap Trick music when I was younger. Now that I'm an adult who can listen to whatever damn music I want, like a big boy, I just haven't dedicated the time to check out their stuff. I don't know. It's on my list. But I enjoyed listening to this song. How much of the music you know by Cheap Trick is similar to this? Is this like an exception as far as hard rocking?
There's a lot of hard rocking stuff, and it's got the roll to it, like this one,
Yeah,
where it's not just a rock. It's sure. Got that kind of whatever kind of fun sort of vibe to it. There's a good amount of it from.
Yeah,
I'd say from this era particularly. I mean, there's stuff I've gone and listened to from the stuff from the 80s, and I'm not an expert on it, but they kind of, I think they were going a little different direction, because the Flame was probably their biggest hit at that point
in the 80s.
Yeah. So that's not like this. there's some really good, like the Hot Love, their first song on the first album, is kind of this kind of vibe.
Okay.
So, they mix it up, but there's some stuff that's a little more textured and darker,
I think that's what I assume that more of their catalog was like a Nick or Chris pair of socks versus an Andy or Tom pair of socks. I'm happy to know. I'm happy to know there's a good mix.
It's a good mix. Yeah, you should check it out.
Yeah, I think you'd be pleasantly surprised that that's not the case, especially certainly with the first four studio albums and Budokan. I think you'd find plenty that you would like. 80s were not. The Flame was an outlier. You know, they had some pretty good rockin' tunes coming out in the 80s, but
They've been prolific for, right? I mean, they haven't stopped. They've been chugging along all this time, so.
Still?
Right? And there's plenty of material
new stuff,
out there.
Yeah. Still coming out?
Yeah, I don't have the list in front of me, but they probably put out 5 or 6 albums in the 80s. Maybe 3 or 4 in the 90s.
Yeah.
I think they've slowed down since then.
That's well, work.
Everybody has, yeah.
Except Chips
they
Enough.
Did a, well, they did
thanks,
a...
Thanks for bringing him up.
Well, I guess he's one of the other Chicago area guys, right?
He is, isn't he?
Fucking deal.
Blue Island.
Yeah, that's right.
Not Blue Chicago, Island. Blue Island.
Yeah.
Great.
A mecca in that of case, artists
in
from
that
Chicago.
Case, say you're from Chicago. Nobody gives a fuck if you're from Blue Island, especially him. Anyway, go. What were you saying?
I don't remember. I honestly forgot.
You were talking about the prolific. Everyone slowed down. And Tom.
No,
said,
I was just saying that they've. I don't know how many years ago it was, but they did like a live album where it was the Sgt. Pepper album fairly recently. So, I mean, they're still kind of making
just
albums.
They covered that album?
Yeah, they're still making albums. I don't know how much like original stuff they...
Same there, four there was, guys too?
No, it's... I think it's the three guys still.
Well, it's...
But it's
Rick Nielsen's son is the drummer now.
Okay.
And then for much of the 80s, Tom Peterson was not in the band. Well, no, not for much. For the first half of the 80s, roughly. But for several years there, he was not in the band. They had two other bass players, and then he rejoined.
Yeah, so, I mean, they're still out there doing it.
They had two other bass players because they couldn't handle the 12-string. They needed they needed two people.
Yeah, two six-stringers. So, what happens now?
Well, geez, who would have thought?
All right, Hammond!
All right, Rockford.
I got a question for you.
Hammond's greatest export? The first 50 episodes of Pot of Thunder?
Could be. Of this millennium, at least.
Yeah. Interesting. So the question is, Paul Stanley wants to know if Stiff Competition is a rock and roll boner classic.
Yeah, we can do all four words tonight.
Yeah.
All right.
Don't do the Bon Scott version.
So again.
Which is a good version, don't get me wrong. And it's the version we have to do when there's just three of us. But
yeah.
So wow, the bar's raised even higher. Even harder to get hard, if you will.
Yeah,
you're gonna have to put two basketball shoe tongues in your nutsack to get the proper inflation for this one.
Surprised. see, this was 78. Surprised. Dynasty didn't have a song written by Gene Simmons called "Stiff Proposition."
How did that never happen with a Kiss song? He said it so many times.
Not even on any of his solo albums, is it?
Maybe it's on the. That box of shit he put out a couple of years ago.
Box of garbage.
Anybody you know? Anybody get it?
Some of the people
I'm sure
the
listeners
to the show,
did.
Yeah, I've people. Never seen it in person though.
Yeah. Did they have it delivered? Do you get it delivered?
No,
they
you have to go. CG'd.
They went.
They
you
went.
Could get it delivered, but
it was like 20 grand or
something.
Yeah. Big cash.
But if you wanted to go to the Vault Experience at a venue near you and pick
it
up.
That was still, what, a few grand?
Two, I think?
Something like that,
Two grand, I think.
And our boy Kevin Jepsen did that.
Yeah.
That guy's just hemorrhaging cash from what I can tell. That's what, every time he posts some of his goings on, I comment on Facebook. I go, Gates, Bezos, Jepsen. It's like those three. Those three have all the wealth in America.
Followed by Musk, closely by Musk.
Yeah.
And then it's at the bottom, it's
boner doctor and these three boners. That's
right. We're below the boner doctor.
We're the bottom four. Yeah.
Inflatable. We're the pizza tree beneath the boner.
We don't even have
struggling to hold it up.
We don't. There's not even utterance of us getting any sort of honorary doctorate in KISS podcasting.
Nothing. You think that would have happened for all the work we put in and all the research we did?
Nothing. Doctors of KISS podcasting.
Some
no.
kind of university should probably reach out to us, but
yeah, you know,
no respect in our lifetimes.
Must
no,
be
that's
all.
What, that's what I, a they loser must, likes to tell himself.
Maybe
like
they're just foreseeing all the imminent scandal that's going to be.
A la Bill Cosby.
Yeah.
Exactly. Let's not even give it out.
Yeah, we're just going to have to revoke it anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, they don't want to go down that road.
Yeah.
Anyway, my vote's in.
Vote's in. Tom?
Mine's in. Andy, go first. Or
what are we doing?
We're doing shit. Rock and roll.
No, rock. Wait.
And roll.
Boner.
Boner.
Yes. I didn't know at the time. I was telling you that his favorite wrestling faction was the Four Horsemen.
What's the negative vote? It's just
I think it's
no boner.
I think
is that
it's just improv it.
Yeah. He pulled a turkey.
You could do the sound of the
no pump.
The air leaking out.
I was going to say.
I think there might be a little whistle going on down there.
Oh, yeah. For sure.
God, I hope not.
So when you're walking. What if you like do a 5K or something and you keep squeezing your balls together?
What if you walk by a woman in the workplace and it whistles? And
it's a one-way trip to HR.
Absolutely.
You're going to have to bring a doctor's note to prove that it wasn't anything.
That's one of those cases sinister. where you just don't want to try to explain with the truth, because the truth is worse than thinking you're a creep.
Be the creep.
Yeah.
Own it.
He wouldn't even be able to get a doctor's note. He's already declared bankruptcy. He's already up in the... Where'd your doctor went off to? The Alps?
Yeah, you shouldn't be dealing with this doctor anyway. Yeah. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, and I get whistles in my nose because... See? These bad doctors giving you whistles in your orifices.
Not good. Mm-mm. Not what you want. Involuntary whistles out of your orifices.
Yeah, if it was voluntary.
If I can control the whistles coming out of my orifices, that's fine. Yeah. In fact, that's what I want.
I would pay extra for that.
You know. Well, where are we at?
Votes are in.
Yep.
What's the order? What are we going to do here?
You want to go first?
I don't want to go first.
Okay, no. Chris, go first.
Yeah.
So Chris, it's easier for first. Us.
And we're going this way, counterclockwise around the room.
Chris, Tom, me, Andy.
All right, well, here we go. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Rock.
And roll.
Oh, my God. It's a boner.
What?
And he got it! It's a rock and roll.
Perfect.
Oh, yes. I was a little worried about Andy, but that's a worthy boner there. No question about it.
Fantastic song.
I'm going to say it again. I'm ashamed to admit that I'd never heard that song before, but now I'm going to be commandeering this disc and burning it to my library.
I'm enjoying it time and time again. Straight to your iPod. Or do you even use that anymore?
Oh, I use it.
Yeah.
Old school like that.
What's Andy
doing?
Look at those sunglasses.
Well, put it away.
No, we keep talking about this. I feel like we have to put it in context.
No, we don't have to do anything. This is our show.
But I think it's funny to listen to it again. No? All right.
We could just say the clip that is now behind the victory song there.
Mm-hmm.
Is what's the name of the the YouTube video? It's part of the tirade.
It's called Pete Weber. God damn it! I did it. Who do you think you are? Yeah, professional bowling from ESPN.
Yeah, it's just a maniacal outburst by a professional athlete. Although, can you call a bowler an athlete? Really,
a hobbyist,
more of a game
know.
Player.
I don't but
surprised there's not Olympic bowling. Maybe Tom could be, since he's not pro. Tom could be on the Olympic
team.
Too
old for that, but maybe
is Tom too old for that?
Is there an age limit?
No,
is
there? I don't think so. Man. Some of those curling guys are pretty old.
That's true.
But
that's you, Nick.
That's me, Nick.
You've curled, right?
Never curled.
I thought you curled.
I'd like to.
Nick wants to curl.
There's a place in Chicago that does it.
There's a few places.
Yeah, there's a restaurant that freezes over their outdoor patio.
Really?
In the winter months.
Wow.
Yeah, how can they put it? Is it a quality curl? What do they call a curling
field? I want to say a pitch. What do you think? Nick probably knows.
I want to say they call it the... Oh, man. I'm going to look stupid. Is it the sheet?
No, see.
I mean, you got to have a pretty... You got to have a pretty precision playing surface for that,
and
right?
And they got to spray it.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's a little beads
on
it.
Some fucking joint freezing over their outdoor patio. That's not a proper curling venue. Fuck them.
That's a load of shit.
Anybody
who
goes and curls there is an asshole.
Curling sheet. Next right.
Curling sheet.
Don't go to that place. They're amateurs. They're half-asses. They're dickheads.
They don't. I heard they don't have you do the broom.
Then
either.
It's not curling.
It's not curling.
They don't
want,
who are these
they
assholes?
They don't want people eating, like, you know, a bratwurst sandwich and then having a heart attack. You know.
Fuck them then. Don't have it.
Yeah. Then don't do it.
Don't,
I think
don't. It's not ice shuffleboard. Okay. There's a right way to do it. Don't do it if you're not going to do it the right way.
This is like having a
what's
pump
the name
installed
of
in your
place?
Boner.
What's the name of this place? Do you know?
Kaiser Tiger.
Kaiser Tiger, that's
That
yeah.
place. Okay, yeah. I used to work over there. Stop doing what you're doing. It's lame. It's half-ass. Stop doing what you're doing.
Do you know what the target's called in curling?
The house.
That's the house. Nick knows his curling.
Take it to the house.
It's the only sport I watch regularly.
You just like the
and
screaming.
I'm not trying to just be weird. It's just
regularly.
Do they still?
Yeah,
have
they have World
Friday
Cups
night. Friday night curling on. Was it on NBC?
Curling night in America.
CBS?
Shut up. That's real.
Yeah.
Wow. I thought you were just gonna
kidding,
say
right?
No.
I thought you were going to say it's the only sport I watch during the Olympics. Not
no, they,
regularly.
No, because there's always stuff going on.
So who's like the baddest curling?
It's kind of like the region pro bowling thing. You're making your way around the circuit in Minnesota.
I guess so. Yeah, you're probably right. Even less
and
money.
And then they got to come to the Kaiser Tiger for the Midwest
no
regionals.
No brooms allowed.
Well, you got
BYOB.
A proper curler would not go to that shithole to do whatever it is they're doing over there that ain't curling. It's not, they don't even have the brooms. Get the hell out of here.
No brooms.
It's like, okay, we're going to have a hockey game, but no sticks. Fuck you.
You just
get
throw
out of here.
You just slide the puck down across a sheet
fucking
of ice.
Hipster poser.
I could just see it being up on the
that.
Roof or something somewhere, and then the rock goes right off the building. It's like,
yeah.
There it goes.
Yeah, how about
we didn't have the brooms.
Yeah, throw the stone at the owner's head for coming up with that. It's like, what are you doing? It's so stupid. Okay, we're going to have a baseball game, but no bats. It's not baseball. Fuck off.
It's Tigers baseball.
Stupid.
Damn.
Bullshit. God.
And I still want to go there, babe. But no.
Is that...
Just to check it out.
I agree with Chris, so before you say it, I agree 100% that if you're not going to go all the way, don't do it at all. But maybe the reason that they don't allow it is because they don't want their drunk patrons... running and sliding on ice.
Then
on their
don't
pro-
have
then don't
the whole thing going on.
Exactly. But that's my guess.
It's stupid.
It's ridiculous. I'm assuming if you don't know how to do that, a lot of injuries are going to happen, especially when you're wasted and you think you know what you're doing. You're going to do like the running slide thing.
Yeah. And nobody's got those
terrier.
Nobody
groin.
Has those special shoes.
And they're not going to let go. And they're going to go off the top of the building as well.
Yeah.
Good. They deserve to.
Put it on a skyscraper. All right. Well, hey, if you disagree with us, I'm sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Deal with it.
I don't think anybody's going to disagree.
I'd be surprised. I mean, again, I think Cheap Trick is a band that I think most rockers can find something of value there. And if they can't find rocking value in this tune, I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah.
Probably into fake curling as well. And you need to shove the tongue of a basketball shoe in your nutsack to get hard. kind of man are you? Who would go on with life in that situation? I mean, there's got to be a better way. There's got to be a solution short of that, right?
How many people are you know, it's probably one of those things where there's government grants up the wazoo, pun intended,
good
I guess.
Good one. See what you did there.
Out the wazoo.
Up the ball hole.
Up the man-made ball opening.
Out
the urethra. There's money coming out for researching this, I'll bet.
Yeah. There's got to be a market. Apparently not enough, though, because convenience stores and sending people to... Oh, my God.
Tom wants to propose to all three of us, I guess.
He just came out of Tom's pocket.
Tom just... he brought his 300 ring for us to look at.
One of his many.
One of his 300 11. Rings.
Hey, I didn't clear this up. All 11 of those are league play?
Six.
Six are league play. Six. So you got six rings.
I have six. No, I don't. I have four. Because a while
they
back...
got tired they, of giving them
No,
to
a while back they made... awards once in a lifetime thing. So
there you go.
You know, once you get one, you don't get another
That's
one.
They,
he gets so many of them that the bowling alley, they pick them up monthly at Gordon Food Service.
bulk discount.
You said you had 11?
11.
Okay, so one for every finger and a Prince Albert. That's what you got.
That's it.
And the Prince Albert is the biggest one of them all.
I've been stuck on 11, too, for five years.
The end of your dick looks like Phil Collins' earlobe at this point. It's like dead skin with this unnecessarily heavy piece of jewelry hanging off of it. It's like, get rid of that.
So I guess 11 would be a Tom Kotal dozen right now.
That's pretty good.
Well, think of it. That's pretty friggin' amazing. I mean, I think getting a hole in one in golf is probably harder than getting a 300 game. But again, I've never met anybody. I don't know anybody in person who's gotten a hole in one in golf.
Of all the sports I played growing up, I never hit a home run. I never scored a goal in hockey in an official like varsity game or anything like that.
JV only.
Never touched the ball in football. You know. So this is not to be taken lightly.
That's true.
No, especially in 11. That's crazy.
Never touched the ball in football, huh?
Touched
the ball in the locker room after the game.
I had to use the pump. In
it was the pump.
Room.
He's looking for the pump. That was his excuse.
Yeah.
Oh, geez.
I used the Tom Brady ball deflator. Yeah.
There you go. All right. Well, hey, look what time it is. Oh, my God.
Is it time it's for time. Something else? No way.
Let's yes. charge through Jeez. These. It's been a long episode.
Pitchers and catchers reporting to Pot of Thunder. Tom was a pitcher and Nick was a catcher.
Sure.
The same team. That's a battery.
Don't say that over the waves.
It's true, though. You know what? You know, you want to hear a fact?
I thought
as a catcher all those years.
Through it, go.
as a catcher, I never threw out a base runner at second base.
Uh-huh.
I had a thing one day that I had to go to instead of playing in the game. Tom filled in, threw out a couple of guys.
Jeez, Tom.
And then the next game after that, I was inspired. I threw out my first guy.
Oh, okay, so you did get one.
Tom inspired me.
All right,
being around greatness, contagious.
Speaking of greatness and inspiration, this week's Yardo Questions comes to us from longtime listener David Gutierrez.
Never heard of him.
I still don't understand how.
Tom's never heard of him either.
I still don't understand how this man from Los Angeles got on board with Pot of Thunder in like the single digit episodes.
Yeah.
It's weird, but I'm happy that it happened.
How were you guys even searchable?
I don't know.
At that point.
Right. It's very strange, but I'm happy it happened. All right, so question one. Have you had any near-death experiences?
Too many to name.
Really?
Absolutely.
Wow.
Kidding? Car accidents? various things. Yeah, the answer to my answer is a resounding yes.
Like hospitalization stuff too?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
I honestly can't think of any.
No.
Not really.
Tom?
I have.
Are your Prince Albert caught in the luster kink?
I mean. Yeah, that was I saw the light there, but I've had some pretty
new meaning to the term polishing the knob.
I've had some pretty bad car accidents.
Man, those are the main ones I can point.
I have never been hospitalized, so I've walked away from them. So
that's good.
I was never hospitalized after any of the car accidents, but I've been in a few of those.
Andy and I were in an accident where I would have been. My body would have been destroyed if I had turned about a second sooner.
That's scary, man.
Yeah, like Andy would have been wearing me. Like
yeah, I was in the same situation. I saw the impact coming out of the corner of my eye. It was a manual transmission car. I jammed it down into like second gear and floored it, and the car lurched forward and I got creamed on the back quarter panel. If I hadn't have done that, that car would have smashed full on into the front right side of it at a high rate of speed.
Right at you, huh?
Well, it was. Well,
you
I don't want to talk.
Yeah.
No, it was.
Oh, you were moving.
Okay. Yeah, I don't want to spend too much time talking about it. But like you just said, it's like a split second, literally away from death.
Scary.
No question about it.
Scary stuff. All right. Yeah. Question two: have you had any real life consequences, good and bad, from people hearing the show Pod of Thunder? Is there such a thing as a good consequence?
Yeah, I don't know.
I've had good consequences, just fun experiences of like hanging out with people, like at the Kiss Expo, or when we went to the Gene Simmons solo show at the Park West in Chicago.
Right,
and Andy and I were in the bathroom by, you know, both using the urinals next to each other, talking.
Yeah. Yeah. As you always do.
And listener Rob Goad came out of the stall
and knew who we were.
And
was
like, "Are you guys the Pot of Thunder guys?"
Wasn't he saying quotes from the show?
I think so. Yeah.
And I was like, "Oh my god!" And we didn't know him yet.
No.
We'd never met him or anything.
No, we hadn't met him in person. That was how we met him. So yeah, just like fun stuff like that. Nothing negative. I hope years from now my kids don't hear it and say like, you know, well, you're telling me I can't use, I can't talk about certain things or I'll get in trouble.
Well, it's not you talking about that stuff.
It's your stupid
Uncle Andy and yeah. that other idiot you hang around with.
Yeah.
You got an easy out there.
There's plenty of the word boner has been thrown out as this mouth many times.
They're boys.
That's how grown ups talk.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean that's about it.
The reason that you're not allowed to use that is because you don't know when to use it when you're younger.
Right.
Once you know when to use it among friends,
it's like a firearm, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Take the safety class and then you're okay.
We're highly trained.
Yeah, I mean I agree with Nick. For me, it's all been positive, and the best stuff is being like recognized at certain events that we go to. And then, I mean, Andy will back me up on this. The whole relationship with Jericho,
and all the times
beyond surreal. And I'm not even as big of a wrestling fan as Andy is, but even I can understand that for what it is, being just 100% a result of doing the show.
Yeah.
So,
Tom, have you enjoyed anything because of this podcast? And has it brought any enjoyment to your life?
Yeah. I mean, you get to. I mean, I obviously, you guys, this is your show. You guys do more, but I've gotten to meet a lot of people online. Mm-hmm. You know, through this.
Yeah.
That are, you know, they have the same musical interests as me. You know. You know, it's Mr. Gutierrez. I mean, how often do we chat with him?
Pretty often.
There you go.
Always fun to converse. And I got to hang out once with Jericho. That was cool.
There you go. That was on my birthday, right?
It was. Yep. Yeah, that was when he was in Chris's Jamaica.
He was at his
somewhere.
Daggering weekend.
Yeah. special guest dagger.
They brought you in for that?
Yeah. That was a result of this podcast.
Yeah. It was one of the poolside events or activities they had.
They had celebrity host week.
You have water aerobics, you have the foam party, and you have the daggering contest. I won.
All three. All right, question three.
Underwater daggering, perhaps?
Yes.
Some cement shoe kind of.
Less impact. A lower impact daggering.
Hot daggering party.
Yeah. Question three. This is funny because I didn't read this before I chose this set, this yard, if you will. When are Tom Kodal, Vern, and Arturo going to be on the show? I don't know about the second and third, but I know number one is right now. Tom Kodal's here in the flesh. So
there you have it.
Vern, I don't see that ever happening. No. I wouldn't mind it, but it's not his bag.
Right. It would be a phenomenal event if that happened.
Well, now that we're doing a new format, you should offer. I'd be willing to give up one of my independent pick weeks to let him pick the song. That would be interesting.
All right, I'll pitch it to him tomorrow.
And then Arturo would be the next time we need, you know, some film work done. Next time we go to an event.
Are we bad friends for only hanging out with him when we need him?
Well, I mean, talk to him all the time. That's but maybe true. Maybe we should. I'm sorry, Arturo. I'm gonna buy you a sandwich. And not ask you to film it.
Well, when we all work together, three of us work together at Playboy, and then I work with them at a guaranteed rate. You know, we're hanging out more often. We just don't see each other as often as we would like.
Life, but, you know.
Yeah. Arturo would be another guy to come in and give up my independent pick week to have him, you know, bust out some Morrissey or whatever he's into. Yeah. He's got a very eclectic taste.
He would shake things up, I think.
Certainly
but
would.
I don't think he'd go that far out there, though. I think he would kind of know. He would try to read, you know, the audience.
Maybe.
Try to read Andy's body.
He tried that. He wasn't interested in it.
You should have been wearing your Paul Stanley shirt.
That would have worked.
He'd rather have the audio book of that. Read Andy's body during his morning commute.
I don't know if that's a compliment or an insult.
I don't
or
know.
Neither. Whatever. It's something.
The audio book is where you can really get the essence of the whistling that comes from his various orifices. You kind of need that.
Well, I thought it was
capture his essence.
The Huey whistle.
Yeah.
Huey.
The sound of a giant cock whizzing past your ear. Talk about a near-death experience.
Right.
What a way to go.
Yeah, there was that time when I almost got hit with Huey Lewis's cock. Yeah.
In the bathroom.
If I'd have turned my head a split second sooner, I'd have been killed.
All right, well, thank you to David Gutierrez for listening for almost six damn years listening to this show and also for submitting a Yardo questions.
He's also a big Monkees fan. He was at the new Monkees reunion last weekend. I worked with the new Monkees drummer at the Hard Rock Cafe.
No kidding.
Dino Covas.
How weird.
Yeah.
Small world.
And he...
Gutierrez... dropped my name to Dino, and his response was, "That fucker."
Really?
Exactly what I would expect. Trust me, delivered in out of reverence. We always got along great. And lost touch. I mean, we're in touch on Facebook, but there's zero animosity there.
Yeah.
That's and cool. David Gutierrez and Tom and myself did a. We submitted a song for a Monkees tribute album. Got rejected, but
what a load of shit!
The three of us.
It was, if you know why we got rejected.
What's the reason? Well,
too much toxic masculinity.
Well, there was a lot.
It's a fine line between toxic masculinity and overwhelming masculinity.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's tough to straddle that fence
Tom,
these days.
Tom, what's the reason?
Who is it? One of
Mickey Dolenz's musical director submitted the same song for the album.
Well, how were you supposed to know that?
Yeah. We had no chance.
No chance at all.
That's stupid.
We refuse to listen to
They should have been like, they should have their shoe ins and be like, don't submit these because we got these.
There's that, you can do that, but you could also be like, you're already Mickey Dolenz's musical director. Stand aside and let some fans have a crack at the glory.
Right.
Although, how much glory is there in being Mickey Dolenz's musical director? What's involved in that? What do you do?
What does that mean? What are the responsibilities?
You have to understand his unique and weird drum style.
He doesn't play the drums anymore.
Well, not
does
anymore,
he?
I don't think. But
yeah, it's out front. Him and Torque carrying the torch.
Torque.
All right. Well, hey, if you want to submit your Yardo questions, submit a song to add to the list, or buy one of those beautiful 1.5-inch enamel pins of that newly designed Pot of Thunder logo that Tom's wearing on his lapel right now.
I wonder if Huey Lewis sells like 14-inch pins. No 1.5-inch pins there.
No. Huge pins.
He has to ship them in one of those tubes. Those FedEx tubes.
Yeah.
And by the way, before we sign off, how great a title for an album is sports?
Yeah.
A genre, like a television channel genre.
Well, doesn't it have a dual meaning or no?
I guess.
Always had it, thought it was like...
Well, it meant like sports and big cock.
I guess.
Not that.
Horse racing.
What double meaning are you aware of?
I thought
of?
It meant like these guys are like good sports.
They're a bunch of sports.
Like the guys.
I see. I always just thought it was sports. You know, like.
Like our we had
like a, it's like, oh shucks, you guys are good sports.
Like we had this friend on AOL Instant Messenger. His name was Sports 10. And it wasn't ironic.
It's like, what are you into? Sports.
Sports. Sports is taken by Huey Lewis and his 9 bandmates. So you have Sports 10.
Well, and then the follow up album was 4 F-O-R-E.
Yeah, which lent more credence to the theory that it was just.
Then the third album
sports.
Was Skin.
The previous album was Water.
Then the one in the 90s
no
that did
laughter to that. Oh, come on.
The one that didn't sell too well was called Mulligan. Maybe I should take a mulligan on that.
Yeah.
Edit Tom, throwing a big cock thing. Get it back.
Save us, Tom. Just show us your ring. Ah, look at that.
Caber Toss was the fifth album.
Let me slide it on for you guys.
Oh, goodness.
Easy.
All right. Wow, bunching up a lot of skin there.
All right. Pot
yeah, you've put on weight since you got that ring, Tom.
I was going to say, all those things, potofthunder.com is your place. Make it happen. Whatever you want, do it. It's there. Tom, thank you.
Thank you.
This is your 12th 300, by the way.
Oh.
Good one.
I like it.
All right. See you next time.
Take a sound. I'm looking for your eyes.